Brother McAllister is going to address us on the subject of the spirit of discontent. I believe Brother Allen prepared us well this morning. He taught us, reminded us how we can be clean. I think we can contend with the discontent if we are clean. Brother McAllister.
Thank you, Brother Roman. How can we not help but singing? And yet, there is the spirit of discontent. So we want to do a little defining and see what the scriptures have to say, and what do we mean by discontent. Some words that we could use associated with discontentment is disgruntled. You can be disgruntled, displeased, dissatisfied, that's a discontent, being dissatisfied. Miserable, you can be miserable, discontented, or unhappy, very discontented. And it's most likely that all of us have had this attitude of discontent in varying degrees during our lifetime. But what about as Christians? As Christians, we have an element of discontent or dissatisfaction with us all the time. We are dissatisfied with our Christian progress. We are dissatisfied many times with the progress or lack of progress in the way that we attempt to overcome a fault or resolve a problem. But on the other hand, the opposite of being discontented is to be happy. And again, as Christians, we are happy. We have many references to our joy, our contentment. The one hymn that we opened with, with all the tumult and so on, and whatever we have, how can we keep from singing? How about, oh, how happy are we who in Jesus agree? Happy day when Jesus washed my sins away. He taught me how to watch and pray and live rejoicing every day. Happy Zion, what a favored lot is thine. Our discontent as a Christian should not be that which the world in general experiences. We are living in the time of the end. We are living in the time of the seventh trump. This seventh trump of Revelation 11, 15 to 18. And we'd like to just look at that. Revelation 11. Verses 15 to 18. Again, we're using the New American Standard Bible translation. 15th verse. And the seventh angel sounded, and there arose loud voices in heaven saying, the kingdom of the world. Now, we want to note that both the New American Standard Bible and the Diaglot translation uses the singular kingdom. Who is the prince of this present evil world? It's Satan. He is the unseen ruler of all the present beastly governments. Yes, the kingdom of the world has become the kingdom of our Lord and of His Christ. And we believe that this took place in 1874 with the return of our Lord, and in 1878 with the exercising of His kingly power by raising of the sleeping saints. And continuing with verse 15, and He will reign forever and ever. And the 24 elders who sat on their thrones before God fell on their faces and worshipped God, saying, We give Thee thanks, O Lord God, the Almighty, who art and who wast, because Thou hast taken Thy great power and hast begun to reign. And the nations were enraged, and Thy wrath came, and the time for the dead to be judged, and the time to give their reward to Thy bond servants, the prophets, and to the saints, and to those who fear Thy name, the small and the great, and to destroy those who destroy the earth. These three verses of Scriptures cover the whole thousand-year reign of our Lord, the Messianic Age. And we have that so beautifully shown here on this, on your chart, the Messianic Age. But today, and we're talking about April the 21st, 1991, here in Dearborn Heights. Today, we are interested in the early morning hours of this millennial day. And many of us here remember Brother Narby, and he would have told you, the hour is 2:48 in the morning. 2:48. And already, the nations are angry. They're enraged. World historians have noted that since 1914, the world has not been the same since. In fact, history has been divided to pre-1914 and post-1914. It's been a dividing line. The world, indeed, has not been the same. We have witnessed the end of the times of the Gentiles in 1914. The prophecy of Daniel 2:44 and 45, Daniel 2:44 and 45, was fulfilled. Earth's society is discontented, along with being rebellious. They're not only rebellious, but they're anarchistic. And besides that, they're materialistic. They're godless. Most of the world is godless. And you can add many other adjectives. What about the seventh trump? The seventh trump is also the Jubilee trump. It is heralding the times of restitution begun. And it lasts until the Messianic Age is completed. One of the evidences we see is that the peoples of this world have been clamoring for their rights, real and fancied. You know, Brother Russell saw this in his day, and that's where we get the term, and we've heard this many times, the real and fancied rights of the people. And in our day. I do believe that there has been a day that the newspapers have not carried a story about the rights of man being violated or some infringement of rights that has not been corrected, or even a victory of some rights. There's been some story along that line, along the rights issue. Going back to Brother Russell's day, one of the issues in this country was woman's suffrage. Woman's suffrage. What's suffrage? Well, it's defined as the right of voting in political matters or the exercise of such right. Women wanted the right to vote. Can you imagine that? Well, that's what they said back in those days. Women, they want the right to vote. Terrible. Well, and they finally got that right. You know, they finally got that right. But when? When the U.S. state, the United States Congress, passed the Woman's Suffrage Bill in June of 1919. Brother Russell had been dead for 3 years. And then the 19th Amendment to the Constitution became law on August the 22nd, 1920. From 1776 until 1920, 144 years, the women in this land of the free, did not have the right to vote. They did not have the right to vote. Today, you know, we have the ERA, the Equal Rights Amendment, that would give legal and political and social rights for women equal to those of men. The apartheid policy of segregation plus political and economic discrimination against the black people in the Union of South Africa has been an ongoing issue for a number of years. It's been a terrible injustice to human beings because of the color of their skin. And now finally, there has been some steps taken to give the black people the same rights that are afforded to the white people. And on it goes. The spirit of discontent is prevalent everywhere. We look at television. We read the newspaper, news magazines, and we can see the fulfillment of prophecy. Remember our Lord's words as recorded in Luke, the 21st chapter, the 26th verse, Luke 21, 26. Very familiar scripture to us about men's hearts failing them for fear and for looking after those things which are coming on the earth. On the world. The world sees a rapid approach to the complete destruction of the human race if man does not do something now to prevent it. We hear of preventative medicine in our lives, that there should be more preventative medicine taking so that we don't get sick. The people of this world realize that if something is not done now to prevent the destruction of this world, further down the age, nothing would be saved. If man does not do something, now that's what they're saying. Man has to do this. The scriptures, of course, tells us that these days will be cut short by the glorified church, so that man will not destroy that which God has created. The remaining members of the church will have been delivered and glorified. The great company, the great multitude, will have washed their robes white in the blood of the Lamb. And the ancient worthies will then be on the scene, perfect men, perfect women, who will, under the direction of Zion, the spiritual kingdom, the glorified church head and body, will see that the word of the Lord goes forth from Jerusalem to all the world in fulfillment of the prophecies of the second chapter of Isaiah, the fourth chapter of Micah, and the eighth chapter of Zechariah, especially verses 20 to 23, to name just a few of the scriptures. The Apostle Paul, in writing to Romans, and we have this recorded in Romans, the 8th chapter, verse 19, Romans 8:19, he writes, "For the anxious longing of the creation," and he means he's talking about the world of mankind, "the anxious longing of the creation waits eagerly for the revealing of the sons of God," the sons of God, the completed church, head and body. Of course, the world does not realize that they're longing for peace, their contentment, their equality, their longing for justice, and so forth, will all be realized with the mediatorial phase of the kingdom. And the opportunity, if, again, the little word if, the opportunity, if they choose to walk up, to walk up the highway of holiness that will be opened up. Let's turn to Isaiah. Isaiah, the 35th chapter. And I'm going to read Leeser's translation, and if you'll note the difference between Leeser's and the King James. I think it's a beautiful translation from Leeser. 35th chapter of Isaiah, verse 8, "And there shall be a highway and a way, and the holy way shall it be called. No unclean one shall pass over it, but it shall be only theirs. The wayfaring man and those unacquainted therewith shall not go astray." The whole 35th chapter of Isaiah here is a beautiful picture of the mediatorial phase of the kingdom. And I really like Leeser's translation of this eighth verse, that the wayfaring man and those unacquainted with therewith shall not go astray. All peoples will have an opportunity. And I'd like to emphasize that. They'll have the opportunity to walk up this highway and become acquainted with the righteous laws of the kingdom. And remember, God said, as recorded in the 17th verse of Isaiah, again, I'll quote from Leeser on this, And I will make of justice a measuring line, and of righteousness a plummet, and the hail shall sweep off the refuge of lies, and the hiding place against the waters shall these flood away. Now, I think most of us can recognize here is again an illustration that is used in scriptures that could be recognized throughout the ages. The builder. The builder has been with us from the time of man, really. And if you're going to build anything with bricks or whatever, as Brother Adams knows about that, and you stretch a line, don't you? You stretch a line. And you draw it tight, and that line is straight. They also put a level on it, of course, but essentially the line is straight. So you're building a wall. You know that the wall is going to be straight if it's built according to this line. And to keep it from tipping over, like the Tower of Pisa, you got the plummet. So you drop this plummet, the weight on it, the line, so everything is exact. So now you got the line and the plummet. Now we can apply that, can't we, to the kingdom arrangements. Everything has to square and be built with the righteous laws. There's no bending the line, no swerving at all, no plea bargaining, pleading guilty if then get a reduced sentence or being let off completely for a crime that you committed. No plea bargaining in the mediatorial phase. And what else? In the hiding place against the waters shall these flood away. And of course, waters we easily recognize as truth. We've seen a measure of that today with the waters of truth that have swept away the lies and uncovered the injustices and things that have occurred in this world. The whole world has seen this. They found out that today, as much as they try to attempt to cover up something, it is being uncovered, isn't it? It's not like the old days anymore. You can't get away with it anymore. There's always been those that have been caught and been found, but today it's even more difficult to keep something hidden. But this scripture, when we think of that in the mediatorial work, is quite different from today. The people of the world today are looking for world leaders to solve all the ills that are facing them and bring about peace. We have our Secretary of State Baker going around the world trying to bring about peace. And this is why they are fearful. The people are fearful of these men. They have a measure of hope in them, but still they are fearful because they see an inadequacy in the leadership. I think our president has ridden a high, and now he's faced with the problems of the country. People can see inadequacy in our leaderships, in the world in general. And as men's hearts are failing them for fear, they see this inadequacy to prevent the total destruction of this planet. When the mediatorial phase of the kingdom is established, it will be a difficult time for many people. You believe that? It's going to be a difficult time for many people. The spirit of discontent is still going to exist. There will be many corrections There'll be many punishments, struggles before they begin to make progress up that highway of holiness. We've been subjected to the atrocities and the inconsistencies and the brutalness of Saddam Hussein. The whole world has been brought, he's been brought into the attention of the eyes of the people. And in my opinion, it will be a bitter pill to swallow, to acknowledge, for him to acknowledge that the God of Israel is also the God of Abraham, whom he claims to worship, and that Jesus of Nazareth was indeed the Son of God, the Messiah, our Lord, our Savior, and Christ Jesus, who the Muslims have recognized only as a prophet of lesser stature than Muhammad. We'd like to quote a description of the kingdom. Many erroneously suppose that when Christ's millennial kingdom is inaugurated, everyone will be pleased with its ruling, but not so. Its regulations will be far more exacting than those of any previous government, and the liberties of the people will be restricted to a degree that will be galling indeed to many now clamoring for an increase of liberty. Liberty to deceive, to misrepresent, to overreach, and to defraud others will be entirely cut off. Liberty to abuse themselves or others in food or in drink or in any way to corrupt good manners will be totally denied to all. Liberty or license to do wrong of any sort will not be granted to any. The only liberty that will be granted to any will be the true and glorious liberty of the sons of God, liberty to do good to themselves and others in any, in, and in every way. But nothing will be allowed to hurt, nothing will be allowed to injure or destroy in all that holy kingdom. Isaiah 11:9 and Romans 8:21. That rule will consistently be felt by many to be a severe one, breaking up all their former habits and customs, as well as breaking up present institutions founded upon these false habits and false ideas of liberty. Because of its firmness and vigor, it is symbolically called an iron rule. He shall rule them with a rod of iron. And we want to compare Revelation 2:26 and 27, Psalms 2:8-12, and 49:14. Thus will be fulfilled the statement, "Judgment will I lay to the line, and righteousness to the plummet, and the hail, the righteous judgments, shall sweep away the refuge of lies, and the waters truth shall overflow the hiding place. And every hidden thing shall be revealed." Isaiah 28:17. Matthew 10:26. Do you recognize that? You recognize ever hearing of that? Page 302, Volume 1, A Studies of the Scriptures. Beautiful. Words from the, as we said in the last hour, these again, words from the man with the writer's inkhorn, that wise and faithful servant, under the, and this is under the subtitle, The Iron Rule, in Volume 1. So we see this spirit of discontent exists all about us. How do we keep worldly discontent out of our life? In the book of Hebrews, we have this admonition. We find this in Hebrews, the 13th chapter, the 5th verse, Hebrews 13:5. Let your way of life, or your conduct, the King James Version says conversation, which does not translate the meaning of the Greek. Let your way of life be free from the love of money, which is the meaning of without covetousness, that the King James uses. Being content with what you have, for he himself has said, I will never desert, I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. We want to make the distinction between the spirit of worldly discontent and the spirit of discontent that we have as Christians toward ourselves as it relates to our progress in the Christian walk. We also refer to this as progressing in the school of Christ. We mentioned earlier of the happy hymns that we sing. Certainly we are happy in Jesus, and what a joy it brings to us as we meditate upon our Heavenly Father's wondrous plan of the ages that we have been privileged to understand. A plan that has been recorded in the Holy Scriptures. And now, in these last days of the Gospel Age, the age of sacrifice, and this plan has been drawn on a chart for our reference. And of course, you have this before you, this beautiful reference chart with all that has been made plain for us. It's put down upon tables, and it's been a privilege to understand. Especially we are appreciative in these last days of the Gospel Age, the age of sacrifice, that it has been drawn for our reference. Pastor Russell was asked a question regarding the chart because it didn't show a particular detail to the satisfaction of the questioner. And Brother Russell's answer in part was, and I quote, in making the chart, it was not possible to show everything, and we are surprised that it shows as much as it does. And that's from the question book, page 23, question number 1. And so the point is that we should have an ambition. We should have a goal. We should have an objective or plan to know more about our Heavenly Father and His wondrous plan. An ambition to progress in this school of Christ. We should be discontent with our present status and our present knowledge. discontent with the development of our characters. Is there anyone of this imperfect race who has complete mastery over the flesh? The old man? No, not in our imperfection. Not in our imperfection. If anyone think otherwise, they are deceived. We touched on this in our previous lesson, that we have three formidable enemies, the flesh and the world and the adversary. And if you didn't know that we had these enemies, the Apostle Paul tells us, about them in his letter to the Ephesian church. We find this in Ephesians, the 6th chapter, the 12th verse, Ephesians 6, 12, that we wrestle not merely with flesh and blood. This is bad enough, this flesh and blood of ourselves, but not merely with flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. And then, here in Ephesians, the apostle goes on to describe our battle garment in our fight against these enemies. We are not to be content until the victory is won. Now, here we may or may not have a problem. How well is the battle going? Are you winning the war? We are in the flesh. You know, the old man is with us all the time. He's with us all the time. He's here. One brother reminds me every time he says it, sees me, you know who the enemy is, don't you? He says, look in the mirror every morning, and he says he sees him. Well, we have we're in the flesh, this old man is with us, and remember our studies in Volume 6 of Studies in the Scriptures, Study 15, on the foes and besetments of the new creation. The foes and besetments of the new creation. You might remember how the chapter began. I'd like to quote from the lesson. You'll find this on page 599 of Volume 6 of Studies in the Scriptures. Chief amongst the foes of the new creation is the old man, the old will. Let us not think of the new creature as having two minds, two wills. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways, James 1:8, unsatisfactory to himself and unacceptable to the Lord. The new creature is not double-minded. He has but one mind, one spirit, one intention, one will, and that is the new will, the Spirit of Christ, the Holy Spirit. That's the end of the quotation from Volume 6. Remember when we made a full and unreserved consecration to do the will of our Heavenly Father and to follow in the footsteps of His only begotten Son, our Lord and Savior? That meant we had made a full consecration of our old will to the Lord. And that old will was then dead, and it was set aside from having any control in our lives. We would from that moment be controlled by the will of our head, our Lord, Christ Jesus. Now, this is the way it should be. This is the way it should be, but now we have to look at reality. We are still in the flesh for the present time. The reality is that our flesh is not actually dead, but reckoned or considered dead. The same is true of the new creation. We have a reckoned standing before our Heavenly Father only through the merit of our Lord. If we have been begotten of the Holy Spirit, and if faithful to our covenant upon our physical death, we will be truly born again, this time on the spirit plane, and receive actual justification. If our new will becomes indifferent or careless in maintaining this armor that the Apostle Paul wrote about, then what happens? The Christian soldier suffers a setback in his battle with the enemy, just as surely as a worldly soldier in battle who neglects his armor and his weapons, his flak jacket, his helmet, etc. I was thinking of this recent war that in the desert, of the problems of the sand and so on. It also reminds me, I think some years back, when Brother Roman was in Australia, what was the testing there? They went to Australia because of the severe conditions that existed in the Australian desert and so on. Unbelievable conditions it would subject an automobile to, but they could learn from it. But here it's the same thing, that if certain protection is added to the car, it can withstand that. If the soldier keeps his guns free of the sand and in rust and so on, he's going to be able to survive. The Christian armor in the same way, that we have to keep it on, we have to keep it working, we have to keep it in place, and so forth. There's another paragraph in this six-volume study that tells us a little about our flesh and our old hopes, aims, and ambitions that have been reckoned as dead. And this time it's from page 601, paragraph 2. How deceitful is this old heart? How specious, which means misleading. How misleading are its false reasonings? How many have proven this to their sorrow? How many have been inveigled and had the new mind captivated by the old? How many have found themselves brought into bondage by the deceitfulness of the old heart? One of the favorite arguments is that the new creation is commanded, so far as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men, Romans 12:18. This general advice of the apostle, it seeks to exalt far above his design and to make it superior to the divine command, one, that we shall love and serve, honor and obey the Lord with all our heart and all our mind, soul and strength, and two, that we shall love our neighbors as ourselves. This does not permit peace at any price. If the old heart, the old mind, the old will can get the new one to make a compromise of truth or duty for the sake of peace, there will be no end to the demands it will make. And the result will be that the new creature would soon, in the interests of peace, be violating the very essence of his covenant with the Lord, and be fully submitting himself to the old will, although it desires not to do so, indeed striving against the old will, but led captive by it through its deceitfulness and its skillful misinterpretations of the divine word. The end of the quotation from the volume. Yes, our old man is getting much help from our adversary to introduce the spirit of discontent into our thoughts. We'd like to turn to the Apostle's words to the Romans. We find this, we want to turn here to the 12th chapter of Romans to get the context of the 18th verse of the 12th chapter. This is a verse that was just quoted from the second volume. Romans chapter 12, verses 9 to 21. Did I say the 12th chapter?
Yeah, 9.
It should have been the 12th chapter that we want. The 12th chapter, the 9th verse. 12th chapter, verses 9 to 21. Let love be without hypocrisy. Abhor what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Give preference to one another in honor, not lagging behind in diligence, fervent in spirit, serving the Lord, rejoicing in hope, persevering in tribulation, devoted to prayer, contributing to the needs of the saints, the true believers, practicing or pursuing hospitality. Bless those who persecute you, bless and curse not. Rejoice with those who rejoice and weep with those who weep. Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not be haughty in mind, but associate with the lowly. Do not be wise in your own estimation. Never pay back evil for evil to anyone. Respect or take thought of what is right in the sight of men. And then from the sixth volume, quote, if possible, so far as it depends on you, be at peace with all men. Never take your own revenge, beloved, but leave room for the wrath of God. For it is written, vengeance is mine, I will repay, says the Lord. But if your enemy is hungry, feed him, and if he is thirsty, give him a drink, for in so doing you will heap burning coals upon his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. So we see the context of the apostles' thoughts. None of them have the spirit of discontent, no, but quite to the contrary. We should make every effort to live peaceably or be at peace with all men as long as it does not conflict with the principles of righteousness. But because there is so much unrighteousness, because there is so much discontent around us, it is not possible to be at peace or live peaceably with all men and still be true to the principles of righteousness that have been laid down for us. The apostle writing to the Hebrews, we find this in the first chapter, verse 9, concerning our Lord and the perfect pattern that we have. The apostle quoted Psalms 45:7 when he wrote in verse 9, thou hast loved righteousness and hated lawlessness, that's iniquity or wickedness. Therefore God, thy God, hath anointed thee with the oil of gladness above thy companions. With our Heavenly Father, righteousness is synonymous with perfection. By that we mean it is alike or similar in meaning. Our Lord, as a man, was perfect and able to keep the Mosaic Law. He kept the law perfectly because he loved righteousness and hated wickedness. And his desire was always to do the will of his Father joyfully, because he delighted to do the will of his Father. And as a result, after his crucifixion, he was raised on the third day from the grave as a spirit being, and 40 days later, he ascended to the right hand of his Father. The footstep followers of Christ, those who have made an acceptable consecration to be dead in Christ, who have agreed to give up all earthly hopes and ambitions to do the will of our Heavenly Father, renouncing their own will, and if faithful unto death, more than overcomers, they will receive the crown of life and be seated on the throne with their Lord. And this is the blessed promise that's contained in Revelation 2:10 and Revelation 3:21. These are those who were imperfect in the flesh, covered with a robe of righteousness, of Christ's righteousness, and who kept their robe spotless. These are those who also delighted to do the will of the Heavenly Father. These are those who do not have the worldly spirit of discontent, but whose way of life is free from the love of money, and who are content with that what they have, as the Apostle stated in Hebrews 13:5. Remember also the Apostle's words to the Philippians, and this we find in Philippians, the 4th chapter, verse 11, Philippians 4:11, "For I have learned to be content in whatever circumstance I am." Now, to conclude our lesson, let's look at the Apostle Paul's letter to Timothy. This is 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. And this letter was apparently written between the apostles' two imprisonments in Rome. He wrote his last letter, 2 Timothy, from prison shortly before being beheaded by Nero's men. And Timothy, by now, was an elder of the Ephesus church. And we see that this was a letter primarily instructing him about false teachers. This is also true about the second letter. But let us begin with verse 3 of this 6th chapter of 1 Timothy. And we note that this, of course, has been good advice all through the age, but I believe especially true during these latter days, the time in which we are living. Verse 3. "If anyone advocates a different doctrine and does not agree with sound words, those of our Lord Jesus Christ, and with the doctrine conforming to godliness, he is conceited," which means proud or puffed up. "He is proud or puffed up and understands nothing, but he has a morbid interest in controversial questions and disputes about words." The diaglot reads, "but is distracted about questions and verbal contentions." And continuing, "out of which arise envy, strife, abusive language, evil suspicions, and constant friction between men of depraved mind and deprived of the truth, who suppose that godliness is a means of gain. But godliness actually is a means of great gain when accompanied by contentment." The opposite of this would be the worldly spirit of discontent. 7th verse, "For we have brought nothing into the world, so we cannot take anything out of it either." Remember, you can't take it with you. Verse 8, "And if we have food and covering, with these we shall be content." Content, whatever lot I see, since 'tis God's hand that leadeth me. Ninth verse, but those who want to get rich fall into temptation and a snare and many foolish and harmful desires which plunge men into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all sorts of evil, and some by longing for it have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many a pang or sorrow, as the Diaglot translates it. The true Christian has as one of the many precious promises, but the Lord is faithful, who shall establish you and keep you from evil. 2 Thessalonians 3:3. And may the Lord help keep us content in Him and free from this worldly spirit of discontent. And we pray the Lord's blessing to be upon the words and upon you as an ecclesia here. May the Lord add His blessing. Brother Roman.
Thank you very kindly, Brother McAllister. Two discourses that are harmonious, but from the earthly standpoint, the words are contrary, and yet they can be harmonious when viewed and understood with Scripture and the meaning that Heavenly Father would have us know. We'd like to thank you very kindly, Brother McAllister, for your preparation, your service, and may it be an equal joy to you for having served us as it was for you to be here. We would like to entertain a motion that we would send our Christian love and greetings with the brethren as they travel and back to their own ecclesias. All those in favor, please raise your hand. Goes both ways. Thank you very kindly.
Thank you.
Are there any other announcements, brethren, or comments that should be made? We again would like to individually and collectively thank each of you, brethren, for making the effort. Come a great distance, great effort to join us. We dearly do appreciate it. It's equal numbers, and we feel like we had a small mini convention, and we certainly do enjoy that opportunity. And we should take every opportunity of this kind as long as we are able.
Our dear, loving Heavenly Father, we hallow Thy holy name. We thank Thee for this day that has been set aside to come together as a company of Thy people to meditate upon Thy word, to fellowship with those of like precious faith. We'd ask Thee to increase our faith and to keep us in the hollow of Thy hands in these troublous times, and that we realize the contentment that we have in Thee, and also the discontentment of our own personal trials, and pray for Thy help, because we realize that we do need Thy help to become a victor and to have this victorious faith. Now, as we depart one from another, we ask Thy blessing to be with us. If it be Thy will that we journey safely to our homes and continue to help us to keep in mind all of Thy precious promises and we pray for Thy overruling and help in the keeping of our covenant. Forgive us of our many shortcomings, where we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.